And this morning, my sermon or my message is taken from the book of 1 Chronicles, back in the Old Testament in the time of King David. You can turn with me to 1 Chronicles chapter 21. 1 Chronicles chapter 21. I'll give you a moment to turn in your Bibles to 1 Chronicles chapter 21. And my message to you is titled, Interceding in a Crisis. Interceding in a Crisis. That's my message to you this morning. That's right, the visual has come up on the screen. Interceding in a Crisis. And I'm going to talk about a crisis that was a major crisis in the Old Testament. But before that, Anupama will read to us from that chapter, chapter 21. And verse 26.
David built an altar to the Lord there and sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings. He called on the Lord, and the Lord answered him with fire from heaven on the altar of burnt offerings.
It says David built an altar and sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, and he called on the Lord, and the Lord answered him with fire. David's sacrifice was a sacrifice of intercession. It was a sacrifice of intercession in the midst of a crisis. And today, as we look at whatever crisis situations we may be going through, even in our own lives, maybe something that God is leading us to in by way of a sacrifice towards Him. We will see from David's life. I want to leave with you 5 points. Don't worry, I will finish on time. 5 points from this chapter about David's interceding sacrifice in this critical moment. And I pray that one or two or more of these points will speak to your heart this morning. Because whenever God's word is proclaimed, irrespective of who does it, God speaks. And I believe God will speak to all of you, I believe, in some form or the other, as we share from this passage. So let me move on very quickly to point one. Point one, what I want to share with you, before I share that thought, let's look at verse 7.
This command was also evil in the sight of God, so he punished Israel.
So point one is, the intercession came about in response to a national calamity. The intercession that David made came in response to a national calamity or a national crisis. I will trace the background of the story a little later on, but it was a time when David had done something that wasn't the best. Now, there are debates about what it was all about, and I will not go into all of that today, but I will just share a few thoughts about it. But a national crisis had come upon the nation. And it was causing panic in the country. It was at this time that David went and made this intercession by offering a sacrifice unto God. And as a result of disobedience, the judgment of God had fallen upon the land. And the nation was in turmoil. It was then that David made intercession on behalf of his nation, and he made this sacrifice. You know, friends, we live in a country that has seen its fair share of crisis situations. We went through a very serious war for many years. We saw 2 rebellions, insurrections that took place in our nation. A couple of weeks ago, we had a fuel crisis. We went through other types of crisis situations over the years. But we have seen how whenever the church has prayed, whenever the church has interceded, that God has been faithful. Unfortunately, I think we need to intercede a little bit more, much more, upon our nation. We intercede when the crisis is on. But we need to keep interceding for our land so that God will take our nation to the place where God wants it to be. God would take our leadership to the place where God would want it to be. And you will see how David's intercession made a huge impact at that moment of crisis. You know, I came across a letter the other day from the Evangelical Alliance, and they had said how they were going to have a prayer time to pray over the verses over what we call the hymn for Sri Lanka. It's the hymn we sing at a lot of events, the hymn for Sri Lanka. I think it was written by Senior, right? Reverend Senior, right? And I was thinking about this hymn last night while preparing. There's a lot of prophetic value in that hymn. And in verse 3 of that hymn, if they can put the words up, I don't know, but it doesn't matter. It says, give peace within her borders, twixt man and men good will. The love all unsuspicious, the love that knows no ill. In loyal, lowly service, let each from other learn. The guardian and the, is that the last line? Guarded, till Christ himself returns. What powerful thoughts. And this morning I thought, even as David interceded on behalf of a national calamity. Now we do not have what we can call a national calamity in our country right now. We have peace within our borders. But there is so much more that God wants to do. And who else has the authority and the power to make a difference than the people of God? Would somebody say amen? So I would like you to just bow your hearts in prayer for just a moment. I would invite Pastor Paul Bailey to come up right now. And we want to take a moment to pray for Sri Lanka. As much as David interceded for Israel, we want to intercede on behalf of our nation. This nation needs to see the blessing of God in greater measure. This nation needs to hear the message of God in greater measure. This nation needs to see the blessing of God in greater measure. Would you join? Maybe you can stretch across by holding somebody's hand or just laying your hand on somebody's shoulder as we join our faith together in praying this morning.
Our loving Father, we thank you, Lord, that you are mindful of us. Lord, this morning we understood what is man that you are mindful of him, but you are, Lord. And Lord, we come to you on behalf of this nation. Lord, we come to you on behalf of this people, Lord. Lord, we come to you asking that you will intervene in the course of this country. Father, we see the unrest that is taking place in that Gaul area. And Lord, we come up against the forces of darkness which are promoting this unrest. We come up against the demonic forces, Lord, that are rousing people's passions to do evil things, to do ungodly things. We come up against them in the name of Jesus. And we ask for deliverance, Lord. We ask that you will intervene and bring peace within the borders. Father, we also pray for all the other calamities that have, against all the calamities that have happened and the effects of those calamities. Lord, we see the curse of idolatry in this nation, and we come up against that curse. We ask, O Lord, that you will bring truth to the people. And the people embracing that truth, Lord, will be delivered. And Father, we pray that you will bring economic prosperity throughout this nation. We pray that those farmers who don't know what to do because of the loans will be released from this burden. And Lord, that they will have hope in you, Lord. Father, we also pray for the continuance of government in this country. Lord, these are people you have put in authority over us, and you have asked us to pray for them, and we pray for them. We pray, Lord, that there will not be self-seeking, but we pray that there will be a concern for the people of this country in the laws that are made and in the decisions which are made in the parliament, Lord. We pray that there will be good governance. We pray, Lord, that you will establish your kingdom, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
The intercession was in response to a national calamity. And we need to keep praying for our nation. My second thought to you is that the intercession came about in response to divine mercy. Divine mercy. You know, David was doing pretty well for himself. The nation was doing pretty well for himself. And there are many reasons people have given as to why God was unhappy with the land. But I want to just dwell on one of those reasons. As I was reading through the commentaries last night, it is believed that David's heart began to turn away from his trust in God to the trust of his army, the trust of the prosperity, and the trust of the way God had blessed his nation. David gave an order for his commanders to take a census of the nation, especially of the fighting people in the land. And many Bible commentators believe that David did this because his heart was probably for a while turning towards trusting in the strength of his army and the strength of all the blessings that had come and of all that had happened in the land, the good things that had happened in the land. In fact, even though we are not exactly told what the issue was, it is clear that even his commanders knew that his decision was wrong. Because Joab told David, "Don't do this. Why are you doing this?" So they knew that something was wrong. And David could have turned away from that decision. But David still decided to go ahead and take the census. It's not about counting numbers. I can't help believing that David was having a battle, and the nation, people in the nation, were also having a battle of pride in their hearts. Maybe the people also thought, we were the best in the world. We are this, we are that. It can happen so easily. And sometimes pride can take over our hearts when we are blessed with money, when we are blessed with a good career, when we are blessed with promotions, when God uses us. I remember the first day, you know, in the charismatic movement, there are a lot of things that happen. And one of the things that does happen at charismatic service, when people are prayed for, sometimes they fall. And I remember the first day I prayed for somebody in Kandy. And the first day somebody fell because I prayed for that person. I'll tell you, I felt good. And after a while, it was like I was saying, come on, let me do it again, you know. It's like became all about me and not about the Lord. Now, is some area in your life that is creating pride, turning your heart away from your love and your trust in the living God? Joab told David, why are you doing this? And later on it says that Joab was repulsed, felt repulsive because of David's command. They took the census for 9 months and 20 days. That is roughly close to 300 days. So there were 300 days, roughly, where David could have repented and turned the order. But he didn't. Until the calamity and God's judgment, as Anupama read earlier, fell. Let's look for a moment at verse 27.
Then the Lord spoke to the angel, and he put his sword back into its sheath.
So when David interceded, and in fact God gave David three choices to stay the judgment, or rather as to how God should respond. I won't go into all of that, but David said, I'll rather fall into the hands of God than into the hands of man. And then the judgment of God fell, which resulted in a lot of tragedy. Not a pleasant situation. But David still realized that God's mercy, even in that situation, was far better than the horror of facing the effects of men when they get into war. And in response to the intercession, divine mercy came down. Somebody said the righteous will love God even when it feels like he's angry with them or frowning on them. They know God is still good, even though it may not look like in a crisis situation. Friends, I don't know what you're battling with in your life, but many of us may be in need of God's mercy this morning. But David truly repented and he cried out to God. What about you? I know you've done this a few minutes ago, but I would like us to stand together for just a moment, please. If you don't mind. If you want to sing a song to God, because this song tells us that if we are willing to repent before the Lord, God's grace is more than enough for us. God's grace is more than enough for us. And we want to sing that as our prayer, saying, Lord, I may have failed you, but I'm coming to you this morning in repentance. I know your grace is enough for me. Let's all make this our prayer to our Lord this morning. Lord, give me more grace. More grace. More grace.
It is your faithfulness, O God.
Sing it to Jesus.
You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters and to mercy. And nothing can keep us apart.
Turn to the Lord with your whole heart.
So remember your people. Remember your children. Remember your promise, oh God.
Every hand raised to God.
And your grace is enough. And your grace is enough. And your grace is enough for strong. You lead us in the song of your salvation, and all your people sing along.
Tell your neighbor, that's the truth. God's grace is enough. Proclaim it by faith. Proclaim it. It's good to proclaim these things. So, point one, the intercession was in response to a national calamity. Point two, the intercession was in response to divine mercy. And my third point to you this morning, let's read verse 18.
Then the angel of the Lord ordered Gad to tell David to go up and build an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Araunah, the Jebusite.
My third point to you today is that the intercession came through divine guidance. God specifically told David where he was to go and make the intercessory sacrifice. He specifically spoke to David through the prophet called Gad. And he told him, go to the threshing floor of this gentleman by the name of Araunah and build an altar to the Lord there. At that moment, the angel of judgment was over Jerusalem, over the threshing floor of Araunah. And David was told, specifically guided, to go there. In fact, he went there and personally asked for it as well. You know, we are approaching Christmas. And if you read the Christmas story, especially, you know, we don't see Joseph, the earthly father of our Lord, or the father who took care of Jesus. We don't see him as a striking individual. But it'll amaze you if you read that story to see that God spoke to Joseph and guided him many times over through dreams. He gave a dream and told him, leave this place and go to Egypt. He gave a dream and said to come back to Israel. He gave a dream and said, don't be afraid to take Mary, or a vision. He gave a dream and said, now you go to Galilee. Because God is still in the business of guiding his children. Today there are many gurus who are guiding people. You call them motivational gurus, finance gurus. They use these terms. For men they say guru, for ladies they say divas. Different terms are used. And there are many people giving guidance. But if you are a child of God, always depend on the guidance of God in your life. God spoke here through a prophet. God spoke to Joseph in dreams. God speaks to other people through always, of course, through the word. God speaks in the still small voice. God speaks through visions. I have been hearing many times our Lord in the Muslim community are seeing visions of Jesus and turning to Christ. Maybe you need guidance in some area of your life this morning. I have in my hand, I've used this before as well, this book that has challenged so many people, Pastor Colton's book called My Adventure of Faith. I know all of you have been blessed by reading this book. But I was going through some of the chapters even while preparing this morning. And so many of these chapters have instances where God gave specific guidance. On one occasion, it was about with a travel agent in Bombay. On one occation, it was with a service that a famous preacher was supposed to preach at, which he couldn't make it for, where Pastor Colton ended up preaching. So many stories of divine guidance. And if I ask many of you, you will tell me, yes, I have a story of divine guidance. But you know, we never lose that need at any point in our life. Just because you had guidance 1 year ago does not mean that you don't need that guidance today. When you're at your wit's end, before you try anything else, just get on your knees and ask God to guide you, to give you some sense of guidance in your life. God speaks in so many different ways. And I believe the time is coming in the church when God is going to, we will see more and more of the prophetic word of God coming out in guiding people. Always in keeping with scripture, where the word of God itself will come alive in a new way. Where people will see dreams and visions. Just last morning, I was at the sale and I was having a chat with Pastor Roy. And Pastor Roy was telling me how even from the early days, where even to the point of, if I misquote you, tell me, Pastor. Even to the point of where God saved us. The church in which God saved us was part of that guidance in our life. And I said, amen, in my heart, because that's true. If I was to be saved, I wouldn't have wanted to be saved in any other church in the world, because this was where God wanted me and where God guided me. We never lose the need for God's guidance in our life. And as Pastor Colton often says, where he guides, he what? Provides. He provides. If you are looking for guidance today, nothing wrong from getting guidance from other people and counselors and all that, but first get on your knees and ask God to guide you. My fourth point to you. Number one, the intercession came because of a national calamity. Number two, it came in response to divine mercy. Number three, it was revealed. The intercession was revealed through divine guidance. Number four, the intercession recognized divine value. So David went to this man called Arauna. I hope I get that name right. And David said, I want to buy your field. Because God told him, this is where you need to sacrifice. And Arauna said, you can have it free of charge. I'll give you not just the field, I'll give you the oxen, I'll give you everything you need. Just look at his response. He bowed down before David and then he said, take it. I will give the oxen, the threshing sledges for the wood and the wheat for the grain offering. He was given to go all the way to help David with this intercessory sacrifice. But look at David's answer, and Anupama will read verse 24.
But King David replied to Arauna, no, I insist on paying the full price. I will not take for the Lord what is yours, or sacrifice a burnt offering that costs me nothing.
David recognized divine value. That value has to be placed on the things of God. Sadly, in my ministry, I have found quite often that because God's grace is free, that people treat it as something cheap. Don't ever cheapen the grace of God. Give divine value to the things of God. Whether it's your career, whether it's your promotions, whether it's your money, and very especially with your children, help them to understand that there is the value of the things of God and of loving Jesus. Sadly, a lot of people place their values on a lot of other things. They even inculcate that into their children. So their children feel that if I can do this and if I can do that, now there's nothing wrong with that. But priority should always be placed on value for the things of God. You know, a lot of things come to my mind as I prepare, especially the night before I prepare to speak on a Sunday. But David realized that this was, he needs to give value. So he paid in full. And I was thinking, I talked about some of the younger leaders today, but I was thinking of some of our older leaders in this church. I thought of Pastor Paul Beeling gave up a very, very, what would have been a very successful teaching career in one of the leading schools in Sri Lanka because he felt value for the calling that God placed on his life. I remember Pastor David. And of course, their wives are a part of this as well. So well known in the advertising world and in the printing world. I think he still lectures in the printing sector. But when the call of God came, he placed value on that call. I thought of Pastor Gerald. When the call of God came, Pastor Gerald was serving in the accounting area, accountancy area. He placed value on that call of God. I thought of Pastor Jayanta, who was also working elsewhere at one time, got called to the prison ministry. And he placed value on that call. And today I thank God that he's part of this ministry team as well. What value have you placed on the things of God in your life this morning? How much value have you placed on the things of God? How much value have you inculcated in your children towards the things of God? May God help us. How much value do you place on giving to the work of God? I was also thinking of lay people. Some of them are not called into full-time ministry, but where they God has placed them, they have been faithful and they have served God's calling in their jobs. I mean, I can name so many names in this congregation. In their businesses, they have stood up for the principles of God. I even thought of Nimal, my brother, who had many challenges. So many others. But they have stood up for the value that they have in the things of God. David placed value on what he was going to do, and he refused to accept it free. Finally, and I'll conclude with this. Number one was the intercession came in response to what? A national calamity. Number two, it came in response to divine mercy. Number three, it was revealed through divine. Number four, it recognized divine value. And finally, and I'll close with this, David's intercession would lead to divine glory. Whatever failure you have had in your life, even if all you have from as that fire burnt on the sacrifice, it says God sent fire onto the altar, and as that fire was flickering into a final flame, a spark, God was already planning something bigger. All it takes is a spark for God to do something greater. I'll come to that in a minute, but what are the areas of your life where the fire has died down, where you have faced failure and it looks like the spark cannot come back, where it looks like you only have the ashes and you are ready to do the final rites, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, and forget about it for the rest of your life. You are given up. But God has something better. God always has something better. From the ashes of that altar and that sacrifice, we will read chapter 22 and verse 1.
Then David said, "The house of the Lord God is to be here, and also the altar of burnt offering for Israel."
From that altar, from that plot of land that David refused to accept free of charge, he paid the full cost. He placed divine value. From that altar and that land would come the mighty, majestic edifice that Solomon would build to God for the glory of God in the future. It was on Mount Moriah Because God answered by fire, and he can turn any failure, any ruin, into divine glory. We used to sing a chorus, something beautiful, something good. All my confusion, he understood. All I had to offer him was what? 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 Brokenness and strife. But he made something beautiful of my life. God still wants to make something beautiful out of the ashes of any part of your life. It is said that the famous inventor Thomas Edison, when a lot of his work went up in flames, that he made this comment that when something like this, I may not get the words exactly right, but I'm taking from memory. He said, we will build bigger and better on the ruins. We will build bigger and better on the ruins. If a man can think and believe for that, how much more when the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is with us, can we see that happening in our lives? So maybe you're struggling with past failures. Maybe you're struggling with some sense of ruination or ashes or something that's dying in your life. Dying in your vision for life. Dying in your family. God wants to build a temple there, or something that's great and powerful. Are you willing to allow God to do that this morning? Are you willing to allow God to do that this morning? You know, many times we find, even in Sri Lanka, that churches are persecuted, attacked. But almost always we find that thereafter the ministry happens even better than it, or even stronger than it was before. Because God loves to intervene in the middle of crisis situations. What about you this morning? Shall we all stand together? What I would like to do today, I've tried to have interaction between the congregation. I would like you, if possible, to join with somebody else for just a minute. If your partner is next to you, that's fine. If not, somebody close to you, just join with somebody. Maybe a lady with a lady, a man with a man. Would you just take a moment, please, to do that? There is great power when the people of God pray. Would you just hold the hand of somebody close to you? And would you pray that God would bring divine glory into that person's life today? And I mean, when I say that, I mean not just a prayer. I mean pray prophetically. Prophetically over that person. Pray prophetically over that person's children. You know, a lot of children are going through so many struggles. So many struggles. They are battling depression. They are battling exams. They are battling illness. We need to pray prophetically over our children. So please, don't treat this as another small part of the service. Take a moment and pray prophetically over that person whose hand you're holding. And if it's your partner or your child, wow, what a great moment to pray a prophetic prayer. Let's just start praying and pray for each other.